Welcome back to Paul's Tech News. As we navigate the treacherous waters of this final week of July 2025, it's comforting to be able to use the light of tech news as a guide, shining like a beacon on a seaside hill that says, hey, watch out for those rocks down there. Thankfully, I have plotted a course through these dire straits to the islands of summerization, where we can relax, enjoy a beverage as the sun sets. Cheers. And hear about how poorly Intel is doing, again, as well as AMD Threadripper CPUs launching, again, and some promising leaked GPU benchmarks from a chip maker who isn't NVIDIA, AMD, or Intel, which technically does count as uncharted waters, so prepare to be boarded. It's time for tech news.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by Thermaltake's View 380 XL Tempered Glass ARGB Mid-Tower Chassis. With an innovative dual-chamber design and angled front intake to direct airflow towards components, keeping even power-hungry high-end PC builds cool while maintaining an unobstructed view. Hey, that's why it's called the View 380. Keep things clean with hidden connector motherboard support, keep cool with four included ARGB fans and multiple radiator mount locations for up to 360mm AIOs, and have fun building with plenty of room for cable management and added storage. For more on the View 380 XLTG ARGB from Thermaltake, click the sponsor link in the video description. Each week in 2025 seems to treat us to some new and abysmal Intel news, whether it's layoffs, production delays, or CEO Lip Bhutan's rosy and optimistic demeanor, and this week is no different. Thursday, Intel published their Q2 earnings report where dire statements were made regarding their in-development 14A process, and I quote, "If we are unable to secure a significant external customer for Intel 14A, we face the prospect that it will not be economical to develop and manufacture Intel 14A and successor leading-edge nodes on a go-forward basis. In such event, we may pause or discontinue the pursuit of Intel 14A and successor nodes and various of our manufacturing expansion projects." So, Intel potentially deciding not to pursue leading-edge chip fabrication is a pretty big deal, mainly because it would leave TSMC as pretty much the sole chip fabrication company operating at this level, with a nod to Samsung as well, of course. But we all know how consumer-friendly monopolies or duopolies can be. Intel would also be writing off a huge amount of research and investment into developing 14A, so hopefully this is only a worst-case scenario, but it is noteworthy to include in an earnings report. Interestingly, the report actually showed better revenue for Q2 than Intel expected, but that's likely the result of price cuts and triage. And a letter from Lip Bhutan to employees that Dr. Ian Cutress shared Thursday also revealed that an additional 15% headcount reduction is coming, as well as a return to office mandate in September that will likely function as further layoffs. Headcount reduction as existing employees seek alternative employment rather than suffering through a daily commute like it's 2019 or something, leading to more drain brain from Intel. Even the US government seems to be snubbing Intel these days, as the AI Circle Jerk Summit held in the Capitol on Wednesday included both AMD CEO Lisa Su and NVIDIA CEO Jensen Huang, but not Intel CEO Lip Bhutan. But I'll repeat what I said a couple weeks ago regarding Intel's plight right now. It helps to maintain dual perspectives. You can rightfully see these struggles as the comeuppance that was in store after a decade or so of stagnant quad-core CPU offerings from Intel, while they invested far more into stock buybacks and drone shows than new product R&D. But let's also acknowledge that Intel imploding, or even shrinking to the point where they are not a competitor to AMD, NVIDIA, and TSMC anymore, would be a terrible thing for PC hardware competition, and ultimately, consumers. Speaking of ultimate consumers, those are the people with a lot of money, I assume, and probably the only ones who have been playing around with the AMD Threadripper Pro 9000 series workstation CPUs that launched this week, as discussed last week, which sell for around $12,000 each at the high end, if you go for the 96-core option at least. Thankfully, the poor people Threadrippers without the Pro were revealed on Friday, and while there's no 96-core 9995WX equivalent here, there are 64, 32, and 24-core variants, and just look at the savings. The Pro 9985WX 64-core is $8,000, making the 9980X a steal for $5,000. The 32-core Pro 9975WX is $4,100, or you could save yourself an RTX 4090's MSRP and get the 9970X for $2,500. And the 24-core Pro 9965WX is $2,900, so you're basically throwing money away if you don't buy the 9960X for $1,500. Now, to be fair, the Pro models are compatible with WRX 90 motherboards, while the non-Pros only work with TRX 50 motherboards, which means fewer PCIe lanes, 88 instead of 144 usable, with 80 of those lanes being PCIe 5.0, as well as quad-channel DDR5 RDIMM support instead of 8-channel. But they will be up for sale on July 31st, which is pretty soon. Meanwhile, those Threadripper Pro CPUs that I covered last week have now been field tested since they launched, and that includes a raft of 8 new overclocking world records as shared by Asus that were achieved on their WRX 90E-Sage SE motherboard. Cinebench, Geekbench, 7-Zip, and more now have new high watermarks that likely won't be surpassed anytime soon unless it's by another 9995WX CPU that's overclocked even more. And in another fun test, Chinese YouTuber GeekerWan posted this video using a 1200 liter per minute pump and a 600 by 350 millimeter radiator pulled from a BMW M4 to attempt to cool the 9995WX, which pulls close to 1000 watts under load. Unfortunately, the block interface between the cooling unit and the CPU needs a bit more work, but this probably won't be the last attempt to use some form of exotic cooling on the 96-core flagship. Moving over to GPU news, NVIDIA and AMD might have more competition soon, and I'm not talking about Intel's Arc series. I'm referring to the Lisuan 7 G100 that is being developed in China. Last month, rumors about this GPU were not very impressive, with leaked benchmarks showing performance no better than a 13-year-old GTX 660 Ti, despite the G100 being built with 6-nanometer technology. But apparently, that was an early revision. A new Geekbench entry discovered by BenchLeaks earlier this week saw the G100 topping 111,000 points in the OpenCL test, which puts it in the same ballpark as an RTX 4060 or RTX 2080, and not too far behind the recently launched RTX 5060. And it beats out Intel's Arc A770. Impressive, but one should also note that Geekbench's OpenCL test does not always equate to similar gaming performance, and one of the biggest challenges in developing a new GPU architecture is getting drivers sorted out, which even the established players don't always get right. On the specs side though, we now know that this GPU hits 2000 MHz clock speeds, is paired with 12 GB of VRAM, and supports DirectX 12, Vulkan 1.3, OpenGL 4.6, and OpenCL 3.0. Video Cards even says the G100 is launching this weekend, supposedly on July 26th. But how widespread availability is remains to be seen. I'm also curious to see some independent benchmarks, as well as how polished the drivers might be. Supposedly, they're working on a NRSS upscaling feature to compete with DLSS and FSR, which would be needed, but of course the most vital stat will be the selling price. Let's get into some quick and dirty news next with Tech Briefs. And speaking of GPUs in China, there were some pictures shared by Unico's Hardware on Thursday that makes me think those US sanctions on high-performance GPUs aren't as effective as we've been led to believe. Stacks of full-fat 5090s are being converted into AI cards for use in data centers in this small factory, which includes removing the GPU and VRAM to be soldered onto a custom PCB and switching over to a blower-style cooler that's more effective in a server rack. There's a Bilibili video of the process too, and they seem to have no shortage of 5090s on hand. I have to assume this is a lucrative undertaking given the sophisticated procedures they've developed, and it's further evidence of how much value GPUs sold for AI purposes have in the current market versus gaming cards. At the same time, the GPU formerly known as the 5090 DD, sadly now being just called the RTX 5090 DV2, will be announced August 5th and launched August 12th, per rumors on board channels. That card should be legal to export to China, though its VRAM is reduced to 24 gigabytes, and it's way worse at inspiring wholesome boob jokes, which is just unconscionable. Speaking of unconscionable things, who decided that peak SSD capacity for consumers should be 4 terabytes? It's been 7 years since drives this size first went mainstream with the Samsung 860 QVO, and sure, we've had NVMe options, speed boosts, and a smattering of 8 terabyte offerings in the time since, but those 8 terabyte SSDs remain prohibitive. Expensive. Meanwhile, the fat cats on the enterprise side of the market just celebrated a new high watermark for their high-capacity data center SSDs. Kioxia's LC9 goes up to 245.76 terabytes, which Tom's Hardware conveniently equated to about 12,500 4K movies, meaning that 360 shot of your mom can now fit on a single drive. The LC9 is a PCIe Gen 5 drive that hits 12 gigabytes per second reads and 3 gigabytes per second writes, but of course, they'll be sold primarily to large hyperscale data center companies for AI usage rather than to us home PC enthusiasts, so we finally have enough space to back up all of our sensitive and carefully curated photos and videos that we'd rather not upload to the cloud. Never mind that though. The point is that 4 terabytes is just not enough. Next, there's a rumor from earlier this week that could be very good news for budget builders. The 6-core Ryzen 5 7600X3D, previously only available in limited quantities from specific retailers like Micro Center, might be getting a new revision and possibly more units coming to market. It's too early to say for sure, but listings at retailers in the EU have popped up with a new product code versus the original 7600X3D that came out last year, which might indicate a new revision and a push for broader availability. The big question would be pricing. Listings for 300 to 330 euros so far aren't competitive, but those could just be placeholders. It would need to be in the $200 US range to offer a compelling alternative to the 9600X and 7600X, but the 7600X3D does outperform those chips in gaming thanks to the 3D V-cache. It's also a mystery why these listings have a space between the 7600X and the 3D, but for anyone wanting to claw their way onto the AM5 platform without overspending, this chip could be the new go-to. Hopefully we find out more about it soon. Finally, I'm all for keeping a dust-free PC, but this might take things too far. Scientists from the University of South Korea want to use snot as a dust filter, synthetic snot more specifically, and the idea behind this does pass the smell test, as our noses do a very good job of filtering particulates from the air compared to solutions like the mesh filters on PC cases that have to trade off filtration for airflow depending on the porosity. The snot in this case is a 200 to 500 nanometer thick layer of biocompatible silicon oil, which coats filter fibers and captures significantly more particulates than traditional methods, while maintaining better airflow and lasting 2 to 3 times longer before requiring maintenance. Which I thought would mean an industrial-sized tissue to blow your PC's nose, but the filters can actually be washed and dried before being recoated with more of that snot spray. Tough to say if PC gamers will be up for that level of fan service, but it's more likely this tech will be put to use in hospitals and clean rooms before it's available as a feature on PC cases. Clean PCs run cooler and have longer lifespans though, so these snot filters are nothing to sneeze at. But there you have it guys, tech news for the weekend. If you liked it, click that like button or leave me a comment down below. While you're down there, all of the articles I talked about today are linked in the video's description if you're interested, and you can check out my store at paulshardware.net for high quality merchandise like t-shirts, hoodies, beer sets, and more. Subscribing to my channel is always a good call too. Thanks again everyone, and we'll see you next week.